I guess we'll wait for a few minutes and then start. People are still joining in.
Hey, what do you actually see on your screen?
The Google Meet screen.
It's not giving me options.
I guess you can share the whole screen and then bring the PowerPoint presentation forward, something like that.
No, I don't understand why it's not showing me the presentation itself. I need two screens. Let me figure this out.
Ankush, I think we can.
If I do this, what do you see?
I can see the slide on the left.
Oh, and the presenter notes?
Yeah.
The small version. Okay, so you don't see that. Okay, so why is it not giving me options? Okay, I don't know.
Perhaps if you present the whole screen and shift to the presentation, would that work?
What? Okay, so now you see.
Yeah, I can see the presentation, but then it's not being presented.
Okay. Okay. I have no idea why this is happening. Is that normal on Google Meets, do you know?
I don't use Mac, so I'm not sure.
Which app are you using, Anupama?
I'm using Keynote.
Oh, okay. Keynote. Can you like anyhow switch between the presenter mode, like switch from the presenter mode to the normal presentation mode?
Wait, let me try. What do you see? Okay. Oh, I'm not presenting anything. Okay. Okay, let me try this. Okay. Present now. What do you see now?
Yeah, this is perfect.
This is fine?
Yeah.
Do you see it?
Yeah, it's perfect.
Okay. Okay.
So, yeah, you can keep it presented. So, I'll just start with the introduction and you can switch over then.
Okay.
So, good evening to all of you here. Dr. Sathyamurthy is going to speak today on the brain proposes, the spinal cord disposes, organization and function of cerebrospinal neurons. Dr. Sathyamurthy received her BTEC in biotechnology from SRM University, India in 2008 and PhD in neuroscience in 2014 from the Medical College of Georgia, USA. During her PhD work in Dr. Lynn May's lab, Dr. Sathyamurthy focused on the cellular and molecular mechanisms underlying cerebellar development. She then joined Dr. Ariel Levine's lab at the National Institute of Health, USA, where she focused on understanding the molecular basis for functional heterogeneity in the spinal cord and how spinal neurons are integrated into CNS-wide circuits for motor control. Her work led to the identification of a previously underappreciated circumscribed population of neurons in the cerebellum, the cerebrospinal neurons, which provide direct inputs to the spinal cord and continue to distinct aspects of motor control. Dr. Sathyamurthy joined the Center for Neuroscience at Indian Institute of Science as a Ramalinga Swami Faculty Fellow in October 2020. Her lab is interested in understanding how the integrative action of brain and the spinal cord enables movement and how dysfunction of the underlying neural circuitry leads to motor disorders. So I'd invite Dr. Anupama to take over now.
Yeah, thanks Ankush. So good evening everyone, and thank you so much for inviting me today to, you know, do this journal club. I'm actually quite pumped to be talking to so many, young neuroscientists, so aspiring neuroscientists here. And so today, for the most part, I'm going to be presenting the work that I did as a postdoc. Like Ankush said, it's about the, how the spinal cord is recruited by the brain to bring about movements. And more specifically, it's about the rediscovery of a direct pathway between two really important motor areas of the nervous system, the cerebellum and the spinal cord. So feel free to ask me any questions as we go. I would love for this to be interactive. And I wouldn't be able to monitor the chat screen. So if there's any questions, just feel free to jump in.
I can also convey if somebody puts in something on the chat.
Sure. Okay. Yeah. So today I would like to begin by showing you these rather intriguing photographs. So these are from an experiment conducted by the French physician Duchenne, the namesake of Duchenne's muscular dystrophy. And so here you can see Duchenne and his assistant literally shock the facial muscles of this rather, brave old man. And simply by stimulating a specific set of muscles each time, they were able to produce these really distinct expressions of joy and terror and pain and so on. So in a sense, what's implied in these photographs is how each of our expressions and our behaviors are essentially just a choreographed set of muscle contractions. And these muscle contractions or movements are the only way we can express ourselves and interact with the world around us in meaningful ways. And so one of the open questions in the field of neuroscience is how do we produce movements? So this is a question that has fascinated neuroscientists for a long time now. So some of the earliest clues came from experiments done in the 17th century. So Robert White, a Scottish physician, was able to elicit a flexion reaction simply by stimulating the spinal cord of a headless frog. But he also noticed that this flexion response is lost when the spinal cord is destroyed, suggesting that the spinal cord is both necessary and sufficient for producing simple reflexive movements. But then the underlying neural circuitry remained a mystery for a long time. In fact, at that point, we didn't even know what the nervous system was made of. Now, fast forward almost 200 years, so people slowly started realizing that stimulation of not only the spinal cord, but also different parts of the nervous system could produce movements. So for example, pinching the skin, stimulating the motor roots, electrically stimulating the motor cortex, all of these could cause muscle contractions and could make the animals move. But it was not clear how. So now around the same time, Sherrington, an English neuroscientist who would go on to receive the Nobel Prize for his work on the stretch reflex, got some clues. And his clues came from Ramon y Cajal's work. So Cajal was a Spanish neuroanatomist and a contemporary of Sherrington, and he too won the Nobel Prize, but for something different. So he meticulously described all the different cell types within the nervous system, the motor neurons, the sensory neurons, and so many other different cell types. Just give me a minute, I'm sorry. Just give me a minute. I'm sorry. So it was in fact Cajal who actually for the first time showed that neurons are not fused, but instead they communicate with each other via synapses. Nevertheless, Sherrington, who up until then had been stuck with this question of how the nervous system produces muscle contractions, quickly realized based on Cajal's descriptions and his own experiments that while there are many different paths into the nervous system, there's only one path out of the nervous system, and that's through the motor neurons. And quite fittingly, he referred to the motor neurons as the final common path, because even though stimulation of different parts of the nervous system can produce movements, all movements ultimately have to go through motor neurons. And so in a practical sense, the question of how movements are orchestrated by the nervous system could be reduced to how motor neurons are controlled. And so what are these neurons that control motor neurons? So there are three main sources of inputs to motor neurons. So first are the sensory inputs. So at the circuit level, you have these sensory neurons that detect a wide range of stimuli from temperature to touch. And these neurons can directly or indirectly activate specific motor neuron pools to bring about quick reflexive responses. So for example, when you touch a hot stove, neurons that detect heat can indirectly activate motor neurons that control your biceps. So that's how you can flex your arms when you touch something hot and withdraw your arm from the source of heat. Now, a lot of what we know about the second source of inputs came from studies of spinalized animals, animals whose spinal cord had been completely severed from the brain. And Sherrington and his student Brown showed that even spinalized animals could be trained to walk on a treadmill or produce rhythmic movements like scratching. And so the second source of inputs comes from the spinal cord itself. So you have these central pattern generators, which are these complex array of interneurons within the spinal cord that can coordinate the activity of multiple motor pools to bring about coherent locomotor patterns. But having said that, there are some things that spinalized animals could not do. So they did not have voluntary control over their legs. They could not start or stop a movement. They could not alter their speed, nor could they balance themselves without external support. And so this brings us to the third source of inputs, which are these inputs from the brain. And these are the ones that provide context to any movement, because even though movements are executed by the spinal cord, they are planned in the brain. So overall, the spinal cord is always in constant communication with the brain. So during goal-oriented movements, you have neurons in the spinal cord that relay information regarding the state of the cord and the periphery to the brain. Motor areas in the brain then integrate the spinal information with that from other sensory streams, and then generate motor commands, which are then relayed to different cell types in the spinal cord, which then transform these motor commands into specific patterns of muscle contraction. So overall, this convergence of sensory inputs and descending inputs from the brain really kind of creates this powerful system within the spinal cord that allows motor output to be controlled with precision. And a loss of descending input from the brain to the spinal cord can be quite devastating. So as in the case of patients with spinal cord injury who lose voluntary control below the site of injury. And so I'm sure you'd agree that in order to figure out how movements are orchestrated by the nervous system, we would need to know the organizational logic of the spinal cord and its connection with the brain. And so like I had mentioned earlier, this is one of the main questions that I tried to address in my work. Okay, so what are these descending pathways and where do they originate in the brain? What do we know about them? So the predominant ones are the ones from the cortex, the red nucleus, the vestibular nuclei, and the reticular formation, which is just a group of many different nuclei in the brainstem. But in addition to these known sources of descending inputs, there are also these other motor areas areas that are involved in autonomic control that are known to directly send projections down to the spinal cord. But then, despite their importance, we don't know much about their anatomy or their function. In fact, we don't even know if they truly exist. And one of the main reasons for this is that there has been a lot of disagreement over the existence of some of these descending tracts, because originally, a lot of them were described using these really challenging and laborious anatomical techniques that could easily not be reproduced from lab to lab. So, you know, scientists are humans and humans never agree with each other. So it's not that, we don't know much about their function, but we don't even know if they exist or not. So with the hope of getting a clearer picture, I wanted to revisit this question and really just pinpoint all these supraspinal neurons, all these descending neurons. And in addition to being able to label these neurons, I also wanted to be able to genetically manipulate these neurons to test their function. So to do this, I took advantage of something called adeno-associated viruses, or AAVs. So adeno-associated viruses are routinely used to genetically target neurons in the brain and the spinal cord. So these viruses, usually when you inject it in the brain or the spinal cord, they would infect the neurons at the site of injection and then travel down the neuron along the axon. But for my purposes, I used something called a retro AAV virus. This was developed by the Karpova lab in Genelia almost, I think, 4 years ago. So it's a capsid variant of the regular AAV2, which allows these neurons, this virus, to infect the axon terminals and then travel retrogradely from the axon to the cell body. So then if you inject it in the spinal cord of a mouse, It would travel retrogradely and label the cell bodies of neurons that project to the spinal cord. Does that make sense so far? Hello?
Yes, I'm...
Okay.
I'm guessing yes, because there are no questions yet.
Okay. or everybody's asleep. So, anyways. So, here to label...
Okay. So, Saurav says, could you repeat that again?
Is everybody asleep?
No.
What do I... The AAVs?
Yeah, I guess.
Okay, so retro AAVs are basically just adeno-associated viruses, but they're a different flavor of, you could say a new flavor of the existing adeno-associated viruses. So in this case, this virus has a genetic modification which allows the virus to infect the axon terminal. So it binds to proteins on the axon terminals, and then that allows the that would allow the virus to enter the axon terminal and then be carried to the cell body of the neuron. So then if you use this virus for expressing fluorescent proteins, for example, you can label the neuron based on where it projects. So I'll come to that now. So for example, if I inject the retro AAV in the spinal cord, I should be able to see all the neurons that project to the spinal cord, all the neurons that send axons to the spinal cord. Is that clear?
Yes.
Okay. So in this case, I injected an AAV, a retrovirus, expressing something called a Cre recombinase. So Cre is basically just a bacterial protein, and it can recombine genetic sequences. So in this case, it can recombine the mouse in which I injected the virus is called a reporter mouse. It's an AI-14 reporter mouse. So in the presence of Cre, some neurons will turn red. So in this case, since I'm introducing the Cre only in the spinal cord using an AAV retro, only the neurons that project to the spinal cord will turn red. Right. So
Swikrut asks, so these AAVs and RAAVs transverse between connected neurons?
What do you mean transverse? No, they don't jump a synapse. They don't jump a synapse. Only if the neuron directly talks to the spinal cord, it would be labeled. They don't go transsynaptically, if that's the question.
So it kind of goes like connection to connection, one after the other, something.
No, it doesn't jump synapses. So, for example, only the neurons. So, there are some neurons of the brain that send axons to the spinal cord, right?
Yeah.
And if I inject it in the spinal cord, the axons of those neurons will get infected with the virus, and it will basically travel up the cell body, like up the axon to the cell body.
So just individual neurons would get infected and
colored. Yeah, but whatever is presynaptic to those neurons won't get infected if they don't go to the spinal cord. Yeah,
okay.
Because these can't jump synapses, unlike other viruses which can, like for example the rabies virus. So yep.
Ram Seema asks, here it only labels the neurons in HT, in the final common pathway.
No, neurons that project to the spinal cord, irrespective of whether it synapses onto the final common pathway neurons, whether it synapses onto motor neurons or not, if it just goes to the spinal cord, it will get labeled. Does that
I guess you can go on.
Okay. So as expected, once I injected this virus in the spinal cord and I looked in the brain, I found retrolabeled neurons in all the right places. So the motor cortex, that's what you see here in yellow, the red nucleus, which is a part of the midbrain that is known to be one of the major sources of descending input to the spinal cord, and the vestibular nuclei and the reticular formation. All this was good and expected, but there was one part of the brain that really took me by surprise, and that's the cerebellum, and I'll tell you why in a little bit. So as a grad student, I did my PhD on cerebellar development, and every time, you know, ever since then, I have always been quite fond of the cerebellum. So anytime I got a chance, I would look at sections of the cerebellum under the microscope. And so here I did the same thing. But I didn't really expect to find any neurons labeled in the cerebellum, because the cerebellum is not really thought to directly talk to the spinal cord, even though it's such an important motor structure. But then, quite interestingly, when I looked within the deep cerebellar nuclei, which are the main output neurons of the cerebellum, outlined here in those small boxes in red, I basically noticed neurons retrolabeled not only from the cervical segment of the spinal cord, which controls the hands, but also the thoracic segment that controls the trunk, and the lumbar segments that control the hind limbs or the legs. And so, as I'd mentioned earlier, I remember being really surprised, because this is not, the cerebellum is not an area that's thought to directly communicate with the spinal cord. And so here I wanted to digress a little bit and give a bit of background about the cerebellum. So since the time of Rolando in the 1800s, we've known that the cerebellum is necessary for motor coordination. So without a cerebellum, it's not that you can't move, but you can't coordinate your movements. And that's because throughout your life, your cerebellum has been spying on you. So every time you move, your cerebellum indirectly receives sensory information from multiple sensory modalities. And there's a great deal of somatotopy in the arrangement of these afferents. And so this allows the cerebellum to compute where your body is in space, where your head is in space, etc. Now, at the same time, the cerebellum also receives efferent motor copies. So these are basically a copy of the motor commands that the cortex would send to the spinal cord. And these efferent copies allow the cerebellum to basically build some sort of expectation on what movement you're going to make. And so I'm going to skip this. So by basically having access to all of this information, your cerebellum is able to build this database of the relationship between sensory feedback and motor commands every time you move. And then it uses this database to learn and predict errors in movement and make motor corrections. I mean, very simply put, your cerebellum is more of a predictor. It can predict what movement you're going to make. And if it can actually predict an error in movement, it'll try to fix it. So given that, you know, these errors need to be fixed so quickly, right? Because if you think of any movement, it takes only a few hundred milliseconds for each movement to happen. For example, picking up a mug is going to take only a few hundred milliseconds. So it's quite reasonable to think that the cerebellum should have direct access to these spinal circuits, because that's where the motor neurons are. But that's not what's thought to be. If you look at any textbook, you would see only indirect connections from the cerebellum to the spinal cord. But if you go beyond textbooks, over the last century, beginning with the works of Cahal, the neuroanatomist that I mentioned earlier, there have been a few dozen reports of direct connections from the cerebellum to the spinal cord. These have been described across a few species of animals. But then there was a lot of debate around the existence of these cerebellospinal neurons because of the techniques that were initially used to describe these neurons. And that's probably why these neurons never made it to the textbooks. Not then, not now.
So Mohit has a question, which is, what is the time scale for error connections? Error corrections.
So it's thought to be, during the period of, over the course of learning, you may not learn something within the same trial, like the error may not be corrected within a trial, but it can happen as fast as, maybe less than 100 milliseconds. Does that answer your question? Hello?
I hope so. Yes, he says yes.
Okay. So in fact, you may have, heard of the Gray's Anatomy, the not the show, the textbook. So Henry Gray, in his very influential textbook, remarked that the existence of fibers from the cerebellum to the medulla and the spinal cord is very uncertain. And this was quite the blow to the cerebellospinal tract. And somehow this idea has stuck until now. And because of this debated existence, there are two problems. So one is we know very little about the cerebellospinal neurons. And the other thing is that none of the motor control studies take into account what could be a potentially important pathway in describing how the nervous system actually controls movements. So in my work, I wanted to establish a framework for studying the cerebellospinal neurons by defining their organization and their function. And so one of the first things that I set out to do was to find out where within the deep cerebellar nuclei these cerebellospinal neurons were distributed. And that's because the deep cerebellar nuclei are anatomically diverse and they have different functions. So overall, there's a medial vestigial nucleus, which is important for midline control, for example, postural control. The anterior and the posterior interpositors, which are known to be important for limb control and also eye blink conditioning. And then there's a lateral dentate nucleus, and the function of this nucleus is slightly unclear compared to the others. Okay, so to first define the organization of pre-cervical, by pre-cervical, I mean neurons that go to the cervical segment of the spinal cord versus the lumbar segment of the spinal cord. So the cervical segment is the one that controls the forelimb and the neck, and the lumbar controls the hind limbs. So to define the organization of the pre-cervical and pre-lumbar neurons, I used a dual labeling strategy. So in the sense, so for example, I used, I injected an AAV retro expressing a nuclear localized green fluorescence protein in the cervical region, and one that expresses MCHERRY, which is a red fluorescent protein, in the lumbar region. And I injected it on such that only one half of the spinal cord was labeled. So first, contralateral. So in this case, within the when I look in the brain, I should be able to see the neurons that go to the cervical cord in red, in green, and the ones that go to the lumbar cord in red. So contralaterally, for the most part, I found, so contralaterally means the side opposite to the side that I injected. So for example, if I inject the left-hand side, on the right-hand side, I found what is shown on the screen now. So for the most part, I found only pre-cervical neurons in the posterior interpositus and the vestigial nuclei. And these constitute a very small minority of neurons in these nuclei. You can see very few neurons labeled, right, compared to the entire volume of the nucleus. Now, on the other hand, ipsilaterally, I found pre-cervical neurons in the posterior interpositus, so the ones that you see in green. And both pre-cervical and pre-lumbar neurons in the anterior interpositus, the picture that's below. And these were anatomically segregated, hinting at some sort of somatotopy. And so what's actually interesting here is that previous studies have shown that neurons in the middle and the medial parts of this nucleus actually can respond to stimulation of the forelimb on the hind limb. And that silencing these neurons can actually affect limb control. But nobody knew how. And so here what we show is that there could actually be dedicated neurons within this nuclei for forelimb versus hind limb control. And something more interesting is along these lines, it's actually also been well established that the lateral part of this nucleus, which is empty here, is known to be important for eye blink conditioning, which involves the eye muscles. So our data definitely bolsters evidence for somatotopy. The somatotopy in the sense, the idea that different parts of the brain, different regions within the same part of the brain could control different parts of the body. So, And so before I wrap up this section, there are two other important features that I looked into. So first, we wanted to see what percentage of the cerebellum contains these neurons that go directly to the spinal cord. And we found that only 5 to 10% of all the deep cerebellar nuclei actually have direct projections to the spinal cord. So it's a very small minority of neurons in the, it's not that all neurons in the cerebellum go to the spinal cord. It's definitely a very small minority of neurons in the cerebellum, in the deep cerebellar nuclei. And the other thing is, we wanted to know if these neurons are excitatory or inhibitory, because that's an important feature of a neuron. It matters if a neuron is excitatory or inhibitory. And so we found that almost we did something called in situ hybridization. We looked for, whether these neurons express markers for genes that are present normally in excitatory or inhibitory neurons. And basically, we found that almost 97% of these cerebellospinal neurons actually express markers of excitatory neurons, suggesting that they are excitatory. So, yeah, and this is pretty much in line with expectations from, what we know about the other descending pathways. Okay, so to sum this up, the spinal cord receives excitatory input from the cerebellum, and based on the laterality and the target segments in the spinal cord, these could be classified into three different groups. So group one originates in the posterior intercostates and the vestigial nuclei. It targets the cervical region that controls the forelimbs and the neck. So group two also targets the cervical cord, but then it travels ipsilaterally. That means it controls the same side of the spinal cord that it comes from. And a smaller group three, which originates in the anterior intercostates, but then it targets the ipsilateral lumbar spinal cord. Okay, so next, obviously, we wanted to know what is the function of these neurons. Do they, actually do anything? Are they good for anything at all? So one approach we took was to silence these neurons and figure out, how it would affect motor control. And so first, I wanted to focus on the ipsilateral neurons that go to the cervical cord. So many studies have previously shown that this entire intercostatus nuclei, the intercostatus nucleus is associated with limb control, especially the forelimb. And here, since we noticed a small population of neurons with direct projection to the cervical cord, we wanted to silence only this specific group of neurons and see if this would actually affect, limb control, forelimb control. So to specifically silence only these neurons, we used something called chemogenetics. So we used a three-part strategy. So overall, the idea is I injected AAV retro expressing Cre in one half of the spinal cord, the cervical cord. Second, I injected a Cre-dependent HM4DI. So HM4DI I'm sure you guys have heard of muscarinic receptors. So these are receptors for acetylcholine. So HM4DI is basically just a mutant version of the receptor. And what it does is when it's bound to this chemical called CNO, it would actually hyperpolarize a neuron. So it would basically silence the neuron. And finally, we give these animals CNO, which is the ligand that can activate HM4DI. And when we give these mice CNO intraperitoneally, we can basically silence just the cerebellospinal neurons that go to the forelimb area of the spinal cord ipsilaterally. Is this clear so far?
So while you inject the retrovirus, how does that interact with the CNO and the HM4DI?
Okay, so the retrovirus basically just contains Cre. So Cre is just a recombinase. Now, within the deep cerebellar nuclei, I inject a regular AAV. This is not a retro AAV. A regular AAV that expresses Cre-dependent HM4DI. So only the cells that express Cre will now express HM4DI because of the way the virus, the plasmid is made. So then only the cells that project to the spinal cord that are in that location will actually express the HM4DI. And only the cells that express HM4DI can interact, will get silenced when I give the animals CNO.
Okay, yeah, understood. So Karthik Krishnamurthy asks, would you expect the loss of function of these cerebrospinal neurons in amyotrophic lateral sclerosis?
We don't know. I mean, I don't, so ALS is thought to be more of a motor neuron problem. And this neuron, so if you, so I'll basically come to that. So if you mess with these neurons, you don't really lose locomotion. You don't lose motor function. It only affects motor coordination. So it's not that you can't move. It's just that your coordination is affected.
Okay. So Ramasimha asks, does HM4DI change the receptors in the neurons?
Does HM4DI change the receptors in the neurons? So just the overexpression of HM4DI doesn't affect the neurons. And we know that because, I mean, it's been well established. Just expressing this receptor wouldn't affect neuron function. But we also use animals that express HM4DI as controls. So we don't give them CNO, we just give them saline. And that doesn't seem to, you know, affect motor function.
Okay, Amartya says, I might have missed it, but do you inject via stereotactic surgeries?
Yeah, so we basically hit only the, I mean, we hit the spinal cord with the first injection, and with the second injection, we hit the cerebellum. So you see that red needle positioned over the deep cerebellar nuclei? So that's where we usually try to position the needle.
Mohit asks, will this motor coordination result in something like tremors?
Yeah, so that'll show that. We haven't like looked into that carefully, but I would show some you know, examples of that.
Sure, we can go on, I guess.
Okay. So overall, I had a bunch of mice, but I had silenced these neurons by giving them, you know, doing those injections. And giving the animals the drug, CNO, and as controls, the mice, you know, received the same virus, the same injections, but instead of CNO, they received saline. So basically, those in those animals, the neurons should not be silenced. And so, and then I ran the animals through something called a single pellet retrieval assay. So in this task, mice are food restricted. So they're a little bit hungry all the time, and they're trained and they're put in a box, and they're trained to reach their arms out of a box and grasp a food pellet. So the food pellet is usually like really small, the one that you see on the pedestal there on that red thing. So they're given about 20 to 40 trials a day, and each trial is scored as a success or a failure. So for example, I'll show you here. So you see how the mouse can actually grab the food pellet and put it in its mouth. So that would be considered a successful trial. But it's not that mice can always, you know, get it successfully. This is an example of a failed trial. You see that? So basically, we score the trials as either success or failure. And so on day one of the task, usually the mice start pretty low. They get it right around 30 to 40% of the time. But then over the course of 9 days, as you teach the mice to do this task, they get better and better with a steady increase in the percentage of successful retrievals. So by day nine, the control mice are almost at 60% success. But then mice that receive CNO during this training period, mice in which this ipsilateral cerebellospinal neurons had been silenced, basically failed to improve, suggesting that the neurons, that these ipsilateral cerebellospinal neurons could actually be important for skilled forelimb control. Now, one thing about this experiment is that these mice received CNO during what would be the learning phase, right? So throughout the time that they're learning, I'm silencing these neurons. And so the drop in success could either mean that these animals were bad at learning, they couldn't learn the skill, but it could also mean that, you know, on a minute-to-minute basis, these neurons are important for coordinating movement. And so to distinguish between these possibilities, on day 10, once these mice were already proficient in the task, I divided the controls into two groups, and I treated one group with just saline, or the vehicle, which would, you know, basically mean these neurons, I mean, the neurons are fine, they're firing. And then I treat the other group of animals with CNO. So CNO is basically the, you know, for silencing the neurons. And then I looked at the effect of silencing on the performance. And so remember, so this is on animals that have already learned how to do the task. And so here I found that the vehicle-treated mice had similar success rates on days 9 and 10. So it's not that the performance dropped. It's normal as expected. But then the mice that had, you know, in which I had silenced the ipsilateral neurons, they actually, their performance dropped on day 10 when these neurons were silenced compared to day 9 when these neurons had not been silenced, suggesting that these neurons are constantly required for refining forelimb movement. So it's not that once you've learned the task, these neurons are not required anymore. These neurons are constantly required as you're performing a skilled task.
Hira asks, how do you define increased 60% success without CNO? I mean, were the changes also studied?
I'm sorry, what is the question?
How do you define increased 60% success without CNO? I mean, were the changes also studied?
I don't get the question.
I think she is asking about the first chart where it's showing 60% of the... No. Yeah, 60% got... The 60% got success and then the other section did not.
So what you see in white here is basically these animals are controls. So I'm not inhibiting or silencing any neurons here. So these are just control animals, and I compare their performance on day 9 versus day 10. Right?
Mohit says, I think she's asking,
like, while there is no CNO. Yeah, while there is no CNO, then of course the performance is going to drop. But since mice is learning in the process, so there must be some changes going on in the neurons. There must be. So were those changes also recorded? Like, what is
why
teaching
is it
them to adapt? How
what
they
is
adapting them?
Sorry, your question is what was studied? Why these animals?
How the mice are adapting themselves? What are the changes occurring then in the neurons?
In which mice? The control mice or the test mice?
The test mice.
Okay, so the test mice, so we actually looked, so that's what I'm going to come to. So, so we actually wanted to see, you know, what part of, you know, why these animals were failing. Is that the question that you're looking for?
I'm asking why, while they were successing, how come they learned to grab the...
No. Oh, so these are, so this is basically what you're saying now is in, not the red, the, you know, the salmon color, you know, those are basically animals that had learned how to do the task. And then only on day 10, I give them CNO. So until day 9, they've been learning how to do the task and they've actually been good at the task. But on day 10, I silence the neurons.
Okay.
And on day 10, when the neurons are silenced, that's when their performance drops. But up until then, they've been fine because they've been, you know, they're technically control animals up until day 9. Make sense?
Yes, thank you.
Okay. Okay, so not all failures are equal, right? So there are many, there are actually, you know, you could classify the failures into three different types. So some failures happen during the initial phase of the reach, causing the arm to be positioned, you know, far away from the pellet. I call these failures fail to guide arm to pellet. So for example, here you can see the mouse's paw is not even close to, you know, where the pellet is. It's kind of close, but it's not really on the pellet or anything like that. And so this usually happens, you know, not that often. And the second mode of failure, I called it dislodge pellet. So that's what you see here. The mouse is reaching for the pellet. It's arm is, I mean, its paw is almost on the pellet, but then instead of grabbing it, it pushes it. And this is one of the common modes of failure. So usually, you know, on day one, you'll see mice doing this 60% of the time, and then it will drop as the mouse learns to retrieve the pellet successfully. And the final mode of failure happens during the, you know, once the mouse has already grabbed the pellet. It's kind of sad because the mouse has already grabbed the pellet, but then before it can put it in its mouth, it actually drops the pellet. And this is also not, like the first one, it's not, you know, that common. So usually the first few days as the mice train, they show this, they display this dropping behavior, but then after that, they learn to, you know, correct this. So then we wondered why the animals, you know, in the ones in which the cerebellospinal neurons had been silenced, why, what was the mode of failure? And so basically what we found,
Swikrut asks, does a single trial cover cases where the mouse misses several times before grabbing the pellet?
So usually a trial is when the mouse has started reaching for the pellet, but then, and it ends when the mouse has given up. Right, so in that case, if it tries and then puts an arm back, you know, and then it tries again, that would be considered, that would still be considered the same trial. So it would cover all those trials. Make sense? What is it?
Hope so. Ishana?
Yeah, just one second. Swikrit here. So, hi. So, yeah, just about that. So you said until the mouse gets tired. So, like, is there...
Sorry, not tired. Is until either the mouse dislodges the pellet.
Okay.
So once it's dislodged, no more. Like, it has to stop. It has to, you know, we would start a new trial. Yeah.
So or you don't have a timer on it? Mm-hmm. Is there, like, a timing? Like, they have to do it within these many seconds or so? Or it's just until they get it or they fail?
I know. So usually the training would involve, so mice that cannot cognitively learn to do the task would be excluded from the thing. So usually when we train the mice, they're usually trained to go for the pellet within a few seconds of the pellet being presented to them.
Okay, cool. Yeah, that answers.
Yeah, it's not open-ended. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And mice who cannot go for the pellet within the first few days of training, some mice just don't get it. They wouldn't, like, you know, they wouldn't even get the fact that they need to go to the opening and get the pellet. So those mice usually get excluded.
So Ishana asks, have you tried this experiment with different sizes of the pellet?
No. So this is a pretty standard size of pellet, and it's kind of designed to fit a mouse's hand or mouse's paw. So it's the... That would be interesting to do, try different sizes, but usually the, you know, assay is done with the standard size. So it's about 20 milligrams, and it's usually, you know, the size that you see there. Yeah?
Can I ask a question? Amartya here.
Yeah.
So I want to ask, if is the... effect of the CNO treated behavior transient, or is it chronic? So does it stay, like, for 1 or 2 days? Like, did you follow up after some day?
So it doesn't. So the good thing about CNO is it lasts only 2 to 4 hours maximum. So by then the drug is already flushed out of the system. And so it's a pretty transient silencing.
I see. So after the, like, after two, like maybe 2 to 4 hours or the next day, like, was the mice back to the normal, like the baseline state? Or so was it?
So we didn't do that, but I would expect these mice to be back to normal. But then one of the problems with that is once the mice start failing at the task,
mm-hmm.
they may not want to continue, especially mice that have been doing well. Once they start failing, they may not, they may give up doing the task itself.
But then with the mouse that were given CNO in the first case along with the controls, if you started to train them behaviorally without giving them the CNO for like after 4 days, would it show a similar increase? What do you think?
Yeah, I think we did actually try that experiment and it was pretty ambiguous, because the problem is once they, when, you know, over during the learning period, if they are terrible at the task, they don't, they kind of lose motivation towards the end. And so it's difficult to interpret any results, you know, after that. But I think we did do that, and some animals did show an increase once we stopped them from CNO. Like in the sense they showed a trend towards learning, but it was pretty, you know, it was not clear cut.
Okay.
Hi, Anupama. Can I ask a question?
Yeah, sure.
So hi, I'm Mohit. You mentioned about motivation, right? So so when you showed that chart, that graph, so I was wondering, since till day 9 you had the control mice, right? So yeah, the white one. So after that, on day 10 you introduce CNO. So now, in case you again you know, remove CNO, so it'll again go back up, right? The chart will go back up, the success percent will go back up. Is it
theoretically it should, unless you know, it has a, you know, small effect on motivation or something like that, and the motor control itself, because the mouse could also be, you know, yeah, it theoretically it should go back up if you do it, you know, without CNO the next day. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So I think that was my question. I mean, like, what's in this case also, like, what's the amount of time that you need to, you know, that should be between the introduction and the removal of CNO to check for the performance, if it spikes up, if it goes down, what kind of impact that has on the motivation of the mice?
Yeah, so we didn't look for motivation as such, but then we can't discount the role of motivation completely in this, because recently the cerebellum has also been implicated in motivation. But the reason I don't think it's motivation is we looked at the downstream targets of these neurons. So these go to the spinal cord, right? But in addition, it also goes to other parts of the brain, but it doesn't go to the areas that are normally implicated in motivation and reward. For example, the VTA, the ventral tegmental area, that area doesn't receive any input from these neurons. These neurons go exclusively to areas that are important for motor control, not the ones that are important for motivation. So that's the reason we don't think it's motivation that's doing this.
Okay. So actually I was trying to like think ahead a little bit. So in case you, you know, you introduce CNO into the control line and then you again remove it, and again, maybe after a couple of days, you again introduce it and again remove it. If you continue this trend, will the white line will it dip down to the red line or the salmon line in case of in the chart on the left?
If you give CNO and then bring it back up, is that what you're saying? Give CNO and then...
Yes, if you continue this trend every 2-3 days maybe, so...
So theoretically it should, but the thing with the, you know, but it's basically mouse behavior is not that linear. So many factors, you know, like if you... Especially this is not just a... It's not purely a motor task, right? Because the mice need to be hungry. They need to have motivation to do the thing. So interpreting those results would become a little bit noisy. It wouldn't be clear anymore, which is why I didn't want to get into that whole thing.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Although it would be interesting to, you know, like check, but yeah.
Thank you so much.
Ramasima has one more question, which is, would the CNO injection reduce synaptic strength of these CES neurons?
No. So in the over time, yeah, there could be, so if these neurons are not firing when they're normally supposed to fire, so it's very likely that, you know, it's not forming, you know, all the synaptic plasticity that would normally go on with this neuron is not happening. So it would indirectly affect synaptic plasticity and stuff, but not directly. It's not thought to do it directly. It's secondary to the fact that we are silencing these neurons. Does that answer that?
Hopefully. Yes.
And can we like continue with the talk, and maybe we can put the questions in the chat box? Otherwise, I think it will stretch a bit more, and maybe if you're comfortable.
I am technically okay with time. I would actually prefer this because the whole point is to discuss this, right? So if you don't understand something, I would prefer to stop and, you know, answer questions.
Okay, anything.
So basically, I guess like when I stopped was we wanted to find out which of these, you know, modes of failure was common. And so what we found out was that mostly it's not that the animals were not able to guide the arm to the pellet at all. They were able to get it to the pellet most of the time. But mostly they were not able to, instead of grasping the pellet, they would dislodge the pellet from the pedestal. And so that was the main mode of failure in these animals where these neurons had been silenced. And so also something interesting that we found is that in animals that had been, where these neurons had been silenced, these animals took much longer to actually guide the arm towards the pellet compared to the control mice. Compared to themselves on the previous day when they were on saline treatment. So I'll show that here. So it's the same mouse on the top and the bottom. In the top, it has saline, so it's basically almost like a control mouse. But in the bottom, it's basically the neurons are silenced. And you can see that it takes much longer to actually reach the pellet. So this is another example. Yeah, so, and this is actually pretty interesting because, this is interesting because in humans, this is actually thought to, if you basically lesion the interpositus nucleus, it's thought to slow down movement. And so what we are seeing here is basically silencing just a very small set of neurons in the interpositus can actually slow down movement and actually cause, impairment of skilled movement. Okay, so I think, overall, our results suggest that this very small group of ipsilateral cerebellospinal neurons that project to the cervical cord are important for refining forelimb movements as you're making them. So now, on the other hand, the contralateral cerebellospinal neurons are enriched in the posterior interpositus and the fastigial nuclei. And these nuclei are known to be important for midline control. So for example, damage to these nuclei, both in humans and in animal models, can actually cause postural instability and ataxia. Ataxia, which is uncoordinated, gait ataxia, which is uncoordinated movements when someone's trying to walk. So quite naively, we thought silencing these neurons would actually cause ataxia in these mice, but that was not the case. So basic locomotor patterns seemed fine. So they were able to walk around, run around normally in their cages. They didn't display any obvious ataxia. They also did not, have any differences in the length of the step that they take and the timing of the step and things like that. So we thought, that was a little bit disappointing because, we thought that was like so obvious. But anyways, so we challenged these mice on something called a rotor rod task. So on this task, mice are put on a rotating rod and they're expected to coordinate the activity of all four limbs and the trunk and maintain their balance as the rod accelerates and without falling down. So here, while the saline-treated mice learned to stay on the rod for longer and longer, the mice that had been receiving CNO, the mice in which these contralateral cerebellospinal neurons had been silenced, were not as good as the controls. So you can see that they're on the rod for much for a, you know, much shorter time compared to the control mice. Now, if you think of the cerebellum, it does two things, right? One is it's constantly refining your movements as you move, but it's also important for learning over longer periods of time. So for example, when you're learning how to ride a bike. So one of the questions that this data raised is, are these neurons required both for learning and executing a task, or is it dispensable once the task is already learned? And so we tested this, and we found that silencing these neurons only on day 4, once the animals have already learned the task, doesn't actually affect motor performance, suggesting that these neurons are critical for learning, but possibly not, that's not where the memory is stored. So maybe for recall of the task, the mice don't really need these neurons. Is that good overall?
Yeah.
Okay. So then overall, you know, our data shows that these contralateral cerebellospinal neurons are essential for learning a complex locomotor task. And so since we knew that these nuclei had direct access to the spinal cord, we wanted to know what the spinal targets of these neurons are. And so to do this, because the spinal cord is not just one blob of neurons, it has, it's not just a blob of homogeneous neurons. It's not that all neurons are identical in the spinal cord. There are, within the spinal cord, you see such a diversity of neurons. Many different neurons performing many different functions. And so it's important to know to what neurons in the spinal cord these neurons are talking to, because that could provide clues regarding its functions and, you know, regarding how it's actually controlling movements. So to do this, to find out where within the spinal cord these neurons go, these cerebellospinal neurons target, we basically wanted to label these neurons. And so we injected Cre in the spinal cord, AV retro expressing Cre. And in the deep cerebellar nuclei, we did stereotaxic injection and injected a Cre-dependent virus that expresses Cre-dependent fluorescent protein. So only the neurons that project to the spinal cord from the cerebellum will get labeled with this red fluorescent protein. So here you see the, you know, red fluorescent protein in white. So you can see neurons that are labeled within the vestigial and the interpositus nuclei. And these neurons cross within the cerebellum. You can see that above the fourth ventricle. They go down along the brainstem. And then they travel in the ventral funiculus, which is the white matter on the ventral horn of the, on the ventral side of the spinal cord. And then they terminate within something called lamina 8 of the spinal cord and a little bit of lamina 7. And mostly the neurons in this part of the spinal cord actually provide input to the motor neurons. So the cerebellospinal neurons do not directly talk to the motor neurons, but they provide input to neurons that talk to the motor neurons. And so we got the same results when we looked for not the entire neuron, but just the synaptic terminals of these neurons. So in what you see here in white are the synaptic terminals of these neurons. And you can see that it's pretty much enriched only in lamina 8 of the spinal cord. You don't really see it in the dorsal horn. You don't really see it in lamina 9, where you would normally expect motor neurons to be. Right? And we found that within this lamina 8, almost 30% of the neurons in lamina 8 receive input. Sorry, the title is supposed to say lamina 8, but never mind. So within lamina 8, almost 30% of the neurons receive synaptic input from the cerebellar, contralateral cerebellar neurons. Okay, so I'm just going to, you know, run through this. So within the spinal cord, remember I told you there are many different cell types. So we wanted to know what the target cell type was. And so first of all, we found, I'm not going to get into the details of this. So we basically found that one of the major groups of neurons that provide input to the motor neurons, called the engraved one neurons, N1 neurons, the ones that you see here in white, actually receive input. Here you see those neurons in red. So we found that almost 35% of the neurons that you show here in that are shown here in red actually receive input from the cerebellum. So this was less interesting. And I'll go to the more interesting part here. So one thing about the rotor rod phenotype is that silencing these contralateral cerebellospinal neurons somehow affects the ability of these mice to perform on a task that requires coordination across multiple segments of the body. Because to stay on the rotor rod, the mice need to be able to, you know, control the not just the neck and the forelimbs, but also the trunk and the hind limbs, right? But then I have told you that these neurons go only to the cervical region of the spinal cord. So how is it that these neurons can affect the ability of the mice to perform, you know, this task that requires the entire body, not just the cervical cord? So to find out, you know, what neurons might be mediating this, we turned our attention to something called long descending propriospinal neurons. So these are neurons that have the ones that are shown here in red. So these are neurons that have the cell body in the cervical part of the spinal cord, but then they send axons all the way down to the thoracic or the lumbar regions. So these are not very commonly seen in the spinal cord. You'll see maybe, you know, 20 neurons per section. So it's a very small population of neurons. And so we thought these neurons might actually receive input from the cerebellospinal neurons. And so that seemed to be the case. So here you can see the long descending propriospinal neurons labeled in red because we injected AV retro in a TD tomato reporter mouse. So that's, you know, I mean, the point is you see the long descending propriospinal neurons labeled in red. And then you see we basically labeled the cerebellospinal neurons in green, the synaptic terminals of the cerebellospinal neurons in green. And we found that almost 50% of these long descending propriospinal neurons actually receive input from the cerebellospinal neurons. So that's the quantification. And so we think that's the reason. So basically, I think one of the reasons the mice were not able to balance well on the rotor rod is because these long descending propriospinal neurons were not receiving input from the cerebellospinal neurons because the cerebellospinal neurons had been silenced. Make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, to sum up, within the spinal cord, we found two distinct cellular targets. So segmental neurons, which are important for controlling, you know, the cervical cord, the neck and the forelimbs. I'm just going to skip through these, actually. What is this one? Okay, so these cerebellospinal neurons target segmental neurons, inhibitory neurons within the cervical cord, but it can also target excitatory neurons, the ones shown in red, the long descending propriospinal neurons that are important for intersegmental control. And then I'm not showing the data here, but the ones that you see here in blue, these neurons are called commissural neurons. They usually they're enriched in lamina 8. So within the spinal cord, you'll see them only in lamina 8. And what is special about these neurons is that they have the cell bodies on one side of the spinal cord, but then they'll send axons to the other side of the spinal cord. So in a sense, these neurons will be important for left-right control. And in data that we didn't publish, we basically noticed that even these commissural neurons get input from the cerebellospinal neurons. So the cerebellospinal neurons have access both to local interneurons within the spinal cord. They have access to neurons that are important for intersegmental control, the long descending propriospinal neurons. And they're also provide input to neurons that are important for right-left coordination. Okay, so finally, one thing about these descending neurons is they don't just talk to the spinal cord. So of course, that's how they're defined. Descending neurons basically are neurons that send axons to the spinal cord. But they don't just send axons to the spinal cord. They can also send axons to other parts of the brain. So it's a pretty complex network. It's not like a linear structure where, you know, they just have one axon and the axon goes to only one place. So basically, we wanted to know where within, so, you know, then most likely these have axons within the brain, right? So we wanted to know what the brain targets of these neurons were. And so we labeled these neurons again in green, the cerebellospinal neurons in green. And we looked in the brain to see where we can find synaptic terminals. And basically we found synaptic terminals in the thalamus, which is one of the sensory, you know, gating areas of the brain. It's important for motor control. The thalamus then projects to the motor cortex. We also found synaptic terminals in the red nucleus, in the reticular formation of the brainstem, and the vestibular nucleus and the medullary reticular formation. So if you remember from the beginning of my talk, these areas of the brain that I just told you are actually are the main sources of descending input to the spinal cord. So here you can see that. So these neurons in red are actually neurons that project direct, provide direct input to the spinal cord. So quite interestingly, these neurons actually receive input from the cerebellospinal neurons. And so the cerebellospinal, this would mean that the cerebellospinal neurons not only directly control the spinal neurons, but they also control the neurons that in turn control the spinal neurons. And in addition to, and I'm gonna skip this. So that's that. So totally overall to summarize everything that I've touched upon today, excitatory neurons in the cerebellum talk to all major segments of the spinal cord, the cervical, the thoracic, and the lumbar segments of the spinal cord. So the excitatory neurons in the interpositors and vestigial nuclei are the main sources of input to the spinal cord. So the ones that target the ipsilateral cervical cord are important for skilled forelimb control. The ones that target the contralateral spinal cord, cervical cord, are important for learning a complex locomotor task. And in addition to maintaining direct control over the descending neurons in the brain, the cerebellospinal neurons also target spinal neurons that are important for segmental and intersegmental control. So hopefully today I've convinced you that in addition to the four main descending pathways, there's a fifth descending pathway that's important for motor control. And with that, I would like to thank a lot of these a lot of people who made this work possible. My PI when I was a postdoc, my mentor Ariel, who was my real who's my ideal sounding board, Courtney, a postdoc that I worked with, she perfected the cervical injections and the behavior assays. Kaya and Stefan were also a PhD student and a postdoc. They helped with a lot of the data analysis. And this work was done in collaboration with another lab at the NIH, who helped a lot with the stereotactic injections. And so thank you all for listening today without falling asleep, hopefully. And with that, I can take any more questions or, discuss.
So I'll just clap on the behalf of everyone present
thank
here.
Thank you.
So it was a very stimulating talk. I probably missed something. Like you mentioned, in gate control, the way the neurons from cerebrospinal neurons were affecting that. How did you check that? How they were connected?
How did I do the experiment? Okay. So it gets a little complicated, but I can go over it. Okay. So in this one, right? Is this what you were referring to?
Yeah.
Okay. So here I needed to do two things, right? One is I had to label the long descending propriospinal neurons. At the same time, I also had to label the cerebellospinal neurons. So to label the long descending propriospinal neurons, I basically injected the lumbar region of the spinal cord with AB retro expressing AB retro expressing Cre. And I injected this in an AI-14 reporter mouse. So if I look in the cervical cord, then I, I should be able to, only the cells that actually project to the lumbar region of the spinal cord should turn red. Is that logic clear?
Yeah.
Because they express Cre, right? Okay, and that's what you see on the right. You see neurons labeled in red, and those are the ones that project to the lumbar region. Now, on top of this, I had to label the cerebellospinal neurons. So to do that, are you familiar with, so I'm guessing you're familiar with Cre and Phlox, right? But have you heard of FLIP and FRT?
No.
Okay, so FLIP is technically, it's another kind of recombinase. It's not that commonly used. So like it kind of functions like Cre. It can identify its own genetic, you know, it can identify a specific genetic sequence. So for example, like how Cre identifies Phlox, LOXP sites, like that FLIP can identify FRT sites. So then I inject the cerebellum with a regular AB that expresses a synaptophysin tagged EGFP. So synaptophysin tagged EGFP is basically just EGFP that would be present in the synaptic terminals because it's bound to this protein that's expressed only in the synaptic terminals. And the expression of this protein is dependent, is FLIP dependent. So only cells that express FLIP will express this protein in green.
So if I'm getting this right, you injected from like a bottom up approach for the spinal neurons that were like in the lumbar region, and another one from like a top down approach for the cerebrospinal.
Exactly.
Yeah. So yeah. I am just thinking on the lines of how it would act out, like if I inject a virus, something like rabies, that kind of goes from synapse to synapse, right?
Mm-hmm.
So would it kind of chalk out a pathway of...
So the rabies that we normally use in lab is not the rabies that, you know, it's a modified version of the rabies. So it doesn't jump many synapses. It jumps only one synapse. But if I were to inject it in the lumbar region, I should theoretically, see neurons, the cerebellospinal neurons labeled.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking.
Yeah. So. But the problem with rabies is it's very inefficient. So usually adeno-associated viruses can label almost 70 to 80% of the neurons. There's no technique that labels 100% of the neurons. With the rabies virus, sometimes you'll get only like 5% of the neurons labeled. So it's a very inefficient technique.
Makes sense. But
theoretically, it should work. Yeah.
So Amartya had this one observation. He says it will be interesting to check if learning and motor skills are enhanced when CS neurons are selectively activated using HN3DQ mice lines.
Yeah, so theoretically it should, but then usually these networks and, you know, are much more complicated than that. So what I mean is, for example, if a neuron is not supposed to fire at a certain time, it's not constantly firing, right? But if you somehow make it fire constantly, it may or may not be detrimental for movement. It doesn't automatically translate into better movement. Because the whole temporal thing is gone. There's no temporal resolution anymore. Right? Instead of spiking when it's supposed to spike, if it's constantly spiking, that would mean something different for the downstream neurons.
So another observation that Anil reported to that is it could go either way, since activation will be chronic and the temporal information via spike timing will be lost. Could you comment on that?
Wait, what?
So
I was just commenting on Amartya's observation.
direction, that the temporal information will be lost and it could be detrimental for the same thing that you said.
Yeah, that makes, I mean, yeah, that's basically, it's not a reciprocal thing where, like, if you silence it, it's going to affect function, and if you increase it, it would actually enhance function. It might backfire, if that makes sense.
I have two questions.
Okay.
So one is about methods. So how do you make certain that this HM4DI is actually inhibiting the neurons? I mean, do you test it like that?
That's a very well-established technique. So we did not do those experiments to directly check in our system because we don't, you know, for that you need to be able to do electrophysiological recordings, and, you know, our lab was not equipped for that. But it has been well established that HM4DI expression can actually hyperpolarize neurons. So that's a very
good I meant because we are injecting it in that particular region, maybe that virus is not going to every neuron or...
Oh, like that. So we usually, after every behavior experiment, we would check the brain sections to see if the virus got infected. I mean, if the virus, you know, the HM4DI got expressed or not.
With a reporter.
With a reporter, exactly. Yeah. Okay. Because that's important. And if an animal does not, because not all, if you inject 100 animals, not all 100 would express, because sometimes there could be mistargeting. So usually, you know, you're supposed to, so we would exclude the animals which did not show reporter expression.
Okay. And another question is, is this known, I mean, in zebrafish about how spinal cord and cerebellum are connected?
Mm-hmm. No, I don't know.
Okay.
So it's not being tested in zebrafish, but in humans, actually not so much in humans, monkeys, cats, birds all have this connection between cerebellum and spinal cord. We showed in, you know, in mice, there's been very sporadic reports, but then there's been nothing known, I guess, in the zebrafish.
Okay. The reason I'm asking this is because, I would think that if we can record directly from these neurons, can we get a better understanding of what these neurons are actually doing?
Yeah, I'd love to do that. That's what we want to do next, record from these neurons and also from other descending neurons, and see what part of the, you know, when do these neurons actually fire? Do they fire before we start a movement, or during the movement, or right before we terminate the movement? We don't know.
Okay. Yeah, thanks a lot. Excellent work.
Yeah.
It's pretty interesting, like, seeing just a handful of neurons doing, having so much to contribute to movement.
For at least movement, you have so many neurons, but certain autonomic functions, it's like really very few neurons in the brain that actually do it. And it's really interesting.
I was wondering, do you have any insight on if there are if a particular mice or person has to do a lot of skilled work, or a particular species that had to evolve to do skilled work would have a larger number of such neurons for doing it?
So when it comes to skilled forelimb control, humans are thought to be the, you know, at the top. Because lower like in that hierarchy, animals usually don't. So for example, mice, if you see in the wild, they don't do this skilled forelimb thing at all. So it's not something that's in the natural repertoire. Like, this is something that you train the mice to do. But I'm guessing these should be more important in humans. But the thing is, we don't know if these even exist. We don't have direct evidence to know, you know, if these are actually present in humans or not.
So I guess that ends the questions. And
So how do you decide it? So suppose you find, so these neurons, how do you decide that you have to do these behavioral experiments to find out the function of these neurons? As in, why didn't you do the rotor test for
So we did the rotor test. So we did a panel of behavioral tasks for each of these connections. And so the contralateral ones were not important for skilled forelimb control. Those were important only for that gross locomotor task. And conversely, the ipsilateral ones were not important for for rotor rod locomotion. So that again suggests that, you know, each of these different motor tasks relies on a different set of neurons.
Okay, so for each neuron, each new type of neuron or the function that you want to find out, you have to do a lot of these behavioral tests and then see which one.
So in neuroscience, you have to, this is only for the cerebellum, right? Because one of the most important functions of the cerebellum is motor control. Now, if I were to study the hypothalamus, I wouldn't be looking at motor control. You need to be looking at functions that are traditionally associated with the hypothalamus.
Okay.
Right? So, that's your behavior task, the task that you test the mice on, has to be informed based on what is already known about this particular region in the brain.
Okay, yeah, thanks.
I just have a couple of questions. The talk was really fascinating. When you're talking about the contralateral postural control.
Yeah.
Yeah, you said that, you know, in that rotating thing, I don't know what is
rotor
the contraption.
Rod.
Yeah, what is the contraption called? But you said there was no difference between a normal saline one and a CNO mice, right?
Only after the task had been learned. So that was actually pretty intriguing, and I didn't. We were kind of intrigued by that because once the mice learned the task and we silenced those neurons, it didn't seem to affect movement anymore. I mean, like the performance on the task anymore, suggesting that, you know, maybe the memory of the task is in other neurons, not in these neurons anymore.
Or is it because there's another nucleus on the other side which is contralaterally across the mid zone helping out the postural movements?
That could be compensating, but then...
Because you saw that descending things going on both the sides, right?
It could be possible, but then I wouldn't expect, as soon as we silence these neurons, I wouldn't expect immediate compensation. Although we can't rule that out. Based on the experiments I did, I cannot rule that out, or rule that in. But it is possible.
Okay. One more question was, if there is any cerebellar atrophy or something, how would it affect the downstream neurons, especially the cerebellar neurons?
Do you mean in patients with cerebellar atrophy? I don't understand.
Yeah, or in any specimens which have compromised cerebellum function?
We don't know much about these neurons to begin with. But in cases of spinocerebellar ataxias, these, not just these neurons, but a lot of the output neurons of the cerebellum, or actually the Purkinje neurons of the cerebellum, which is local neurons within the cerebellum, are known to be affected.
Okay.
I don't know about these neurons. I mean, nobody knows about these neurons specifically. But
So would their vestibular functioning also change for these mice? Have you seen any VOR changes because of anything?
So we didn't look for VOR, but we did something called a beam balance test, where the mice are required to walk on a narrow beam from point A to point B, about like a meter. And these animals seemed fine. So I doubt it's, you know, vestibular function that's affected. And I think it's more of an integrative. I think it's more like about interlimb coordination rather than vestibular function. Yeah.
Thank you.
I'm guessing there aren't any more questions. So I'd like to thank you again for the great talk and such an interactive session. And I guess we'll end it here. And
Yeah, it was really nice. I guess I got some of the best questions I've ever got. So nice. Thank you so much. Yeah.
So you could leave the meeting now. And have a great day.
Bye. You too.
Bye.